Disney World is full of amazing and super popular restaurants. Chef Mickey, Cinderella's Royal Table, Ohana. But have you ever heard of Primo Piatto? Or how about The Fountain? These awesome restaurants just haven't gotten their due. And that's what we're talking about today on DFB Guide. Hey everybody, it's AJ for Disney Food Blog. So whether they're out of the way, they're right next to a restaurant that's getting all of the attention, or they're just not for everyone, the restaurants on our list today are completely under the radar. I bet there are at least a few on this list that you have literally never heard of before. That's okay, that's why we're here, to make sure you know everything you need to know about Disney World, especially the things you aren't going to find details on in every other guidebook. So, ready to find out why you've never heard of these restaurants before? Let's get started. Who knows, some of these might be perfect for you. All right, the first reason that you don't hear about certain restaurants at Disney World is that they get overshadowed. These restaurants have some good things on the menu, but they get overshadowed by something even better or more popular nearby. We're gonna talk about Docking Bay 7 first. This is a Star Wars Galaxy's Edge quick service restaurant that's got some unique dishes, brick of chicken anyone, but it gets completely overshadowed by Ronto Roasters next door. Yeah, I know, you've heard about Ronto Roasters. Docking Bay 7 does actually carry the Ronto wrap we love so much after Ronto Roasters closes for the day. Like the rest of Galaxy's Edge, the theming is really cool in here, and there are some tasty, healthy options like the Felucian Garden Spread, hummus and falafel. But if you're spending the afternoon in Galaxy's Edge, you're probably going to go to Oga's Cantina or Ronto Roasters, right? You're probably not going to head into Docking Bay 7. So that's potentially one to take a peek at. All right, Primo Piatto. Disney's Riviera Resort has some pretty great restaurants. We're always talking about Topolino's Terrace, which is the character breakfast and fine dining dinner restaurant on the top floor of the resort. And of course, we've mentioned the tasty pastries at Le Petit Café. We love that Monte Cristo sandwich and the cocktails at the resort's pool bar, Bar Riva. But the quick service restaurant here doesn't get a lot of attention, and it's really only because there's just so much else going on. Primo Piatto has the same South of France-inspired menu vibe. You can get a tuna niçoise salad or croque monsieur. Everything we've had from there is pretty good. All right, moving on to the Diamond Horseshoe. I don't know that we've ever really talked about the Diamond Horseshoe on the channel recently. This quick service turn sit-down meal is only open seasonally. Right now, it's extra seating for guests at Liberty Tree Tavern. Now, this Magic Kingdom staple has maintained its Old West style and laid-back atmosphere, but that's about all it's got going for it. This one is relatively unknown for a reason, and that reason is you should probably just go to Liberty Tree Tavern next door. Okay, Tutto Italia. Epcot's Italy Pavilion boasts some pretty good Italian food, but given the choice, people are a lot more likely to head next door to Via Napoli. Tutto Italia is a perfectly passable Italian restaurant, good even by theme park standards, but it's a bit more stuffy than Via Napoli. It's heavier food, and in terms of decor, it's definitely much more formal. So it's definitely getting upstaged by that killer pizza over at Via Napoli, and also the amazing atmosphere, those huge volcano ovens, right? Plus there are some other Italian restaurants we like better. One's actually coming up on this list a little later. Okay, next up is Skipper Canteen, bless its heart. All right, Magic Kingdom has some seriously iconic restaurants, and Skipper Canteen doesn't always get onto people's lists. Now, we here at DFB love Skipper Canteen, can you tell? With its fun Jungle Cruise theming and jokes and a more adventurous menu than you'll find in the rest of the park. But it's always relatively empty, which means it's easy to get a last minute reservation. And we have to think it's that adventurous menu that keeps it off people's must dine list. Magic Kingdom is full of all-you-can-eat restaurants, plenty of table service restaurants that have things your kids are gonna love. And there's plenty of options for picky eaters, because that's what people want. Skipper Canteen does have an accessible menu, but you'll see some exotic flair and a whole fried fish on the menu too. And the kids' menu isn't necessarily just a bunch of chicken nuggets and pizza. So a lot of people are gonna skip it and go to someplace that's easier. All right, Kona Cafe. When you think of food at the Polynesian Resort, you're probably thinking Ohana, not Kona, which is right next to it. Even if you know about the iconic Tonga toast that's served here, you might not have known that this is the restaurant you'll find it at. You can also grab it downstairs at Captain Cook's at Polynesian's quick service restaurant for a bit cheaper, so it's not even exclusive. Kona Cafe may get overshadowed by the popularity of Ohana, but guess what? Only one of them is open right now, and it's not Ohana. And you can get that awesome Ohana bread pudding at Kona while we're awaiting the reopening of the Poly's more famous restaurant. Still, even though Kona Cafe kind of looks like a pretty standard hotel restaurant, I mean, it's kind of boring looking, I'm not gonna lie. I think it's gonna get a refresh here soon, though. They do serve up a relatively well-priced breakfast and a delicious breakfast, at least for a full-service meal at Disney World, and some more unique options like sushi and ramen, so there's lots of cool stuff on the menu here, and it's definitely worth a try, especially with Ohana not open right now. All right, speaking of boring atmosphere, let's head over to the Contemporary Resort to the Wave. Now, this guy hides out in the shadow of a super popular and well-known Disney establishment. The Wave is literally down a dark corridor on the first floor that you may not have noticed at all if you're coming to the Contemporary via monorail. The Wave has a great breakfast. It's typically an all-you-can-eat buffet situation where you can also order a fresh made-to-order omelet for just $25. But even without the buffet right now, it's still a pretty great breakfast. The menu and ambiance aren't quite as impressive as the California Grill at the top of the Contemporary, and of course it's not as popular as Chef Mickey's. But this is a great spot if you want something low-key that's close to the Magic Kingdom. It's only a 5-minute walk. Now, my biggest issue with the Wave, I actually love the menu. The problem for me is the decor. It really does feel like a 1970s car dealership. I hope that changes soon. And by the way, I'm sorry there's so many restaurants in our overshadowed category here. Initially when writing, there were only a few, but I kept adding more because I feel like there are a lot of restaurants that get overshadowed by their next door neighbors. So sorry that this section is so long, but there's just so much I wanted to tell you about. Okay, the next one I added, Wolfgang Puck Bar and Grill. That's in Disney Springs, FYI. I know you guys have never heard of it. Now, Disney Springs is so full of so many amazing restaurants. There's no way you've been to all of them or even heard of all of them. Now, you may have known that Wolfgang Puck had restaurants in Disney Springs. His original restaurant in Disney Springs was replaced by Haleo, which we're going to talk about in just a second, and he moved over to a different location, and so there's Wolfgang Puck Bar and Grill now, and that's a table service location. Now, you're going to find classic pasta dishes and pizzas on the menu. There's even a gelato bar out front, so you can just stop by for a quick frozen treat if you're not in the mood for a full sit-down meal. The drink menu is awesome here, and really, the food is quite good. They have a really, really killer appetizer, which is like a blue cheese potato chip situation that is amazing. If you haven't had it, it's one of my favorite sort of hidden gems, secret winners. It's really, really amazing. So if you do get the chance to head to Wolfgang Puck Bar and Grill, if you've been to all those other amazing restaurants in Disney Springs, you just haven't been here yet, it's definitely good for a date night. All right, and like I said, we're going to jump into Haleo here. We talk a lot about Chef Art Smith's homecoming and Chef Morimoto's Morimoto Asia, but you know which celebrity chef gets overlooked way too often? Jose Andres. He opened Haleo in Disney Springs in March 2019, and the restaurant serves up delicious tapas and paella. We actually love the food here, but it's so easy to get overshadowed when there's just so much tasty stuff going on in Disney Springs. So if you love Spanish food, definitely give Haleo a shot. And remember, this is the restaurant that replaced Wolfgang Puck's original restaurant here. Okay, we're finally into our second category. These restaurants have got a very specific vibe that doesn't jive with everyone, so that's why you might not have heard about these. They're really for a specific kind of person. So these are going to be the ones that you either really love or you kind of really hate. Now, all of these are in Disney Springs, which is typically open a lot later than the parks, and there are some places that cater more to that nightlife. So let's start with the Edison. This is inspired by the Edison venue in Los Angeles, and it's a 1920s themed restaurant, hosts live music, aerial acrobats, burlesque performances, magicians, and more. Now, the Edison is family friendly until 10 p.m. when it becomes over 21 only. Sometimes there's a $10 cover charge to get in after 10, so keep that in mind. And as for food, the candied bacon clothesline is always fun, but this is a cocktail bar and you can get a $100 punch bowl to share among friends. They also have a full menu, prime rib, burgers, some really incredible stuff, and some innovative desserts. If a steampunk vibe is your vibe, then you're gonna love the Edison. Right downstairs is Enzo's Hideaway. Now, Enzo's Hideaway is literally hidden away, ha ha ha, which is probably a big reason why you've never heard of it. There's a secret passageway connecting it to the Edison, but even the official entrance winds you through some tunnels. There is a full food menu with Roman-inspired pasta dishes, but the Prohibition-era cocktails are the highlight here for sure. It's fun, it's interesting, it's decent food, it's a little expensive, but if you haven't tried it and you love Italian food, maybe this is a good one to try. All right, heading over to STK. All of these restaurants are in the same general area of Disney Springs too. Now, for a long time, I was not super impressed with the steak from STK. Pretty disappointing for a steakhouse, but I did recently have a very good steak here, a very good meal here. So it's back on my tentatively recommending it list. But the thing to know about STK, the vibe here is very modern. It feels like a nightclub with loud music, like exponentially loud music, and low lighting. It's probably not where you would think first to bring kids, kind of after dark, because it is definitely a nightclubby vibe, a Vegasy vibe here, and that's what they're going for. That's what they're trying to evoke. So they do have an upstairs dining room that's quieter, that is probably where you would want to request being seated if you're bringing kids there kind of after dark, but they do serve lunch here. They do have brunch as well. So if you are up for kind of an expensive steakhouse, because it is very, very pricey for what you get, STK might be a good option. And if you're trying to impress a new lady friend or a new gentleman friend on a date, this could also be a decent date night spot. But remember, really, really loud, so hard to hear the person you're sitting with. And we're gonna head over to House of Blues. Okay, House of Blues is half music venue and half restaurant. They get some pretty good acts throughout the year. You may wanna see who's playing when you're on vacation. Now, the toffee bread pudding here is my absolute favorite. One of my favorite desserts in Disney World, if not my favorite dessert in Disney World. It's delicious. Well worth going to this restaurant just for that dessert. But otherwise, the menu is okay. It's not excellent, it's not great, but if you love blues music, if you wanna see live music while you're eating dinner, if you want to go to a gospel brunch, then this might be something that you consider. The draw for most people here is going to be the show. So the restaurant portion kind of flies under the radar. All right, the next category of why you haven't heard of these Disney World restaurants is, well, they're just okay. A few of these have ended up on our worst list when we've asked our viewers for their opinions, though we have had good meals at all of them. But when there are so many options, there's got to be a great meal for us to emphatically recommend a restaurant over and over again. And these are hit or miss. These are just okay. So that's why you don't hear about them very often. Now, this first one I'm going to talk about is going to be painful for a lot of you. I'm going to be honest, it's painful for me to talk about it in this section as well. But we got to speak the truth sometimes. We're going to talk about Mama Melrose. This Hollywood Studios restaurant is very often overlooked. It's another Italian spot, and there are already so many places to get pasta around Disney World. But there are a lot of safe options on the menu here. Nothing's knocking it out of the park, and we felt some of the entrees were a little pricey for what you get. But Hollywood Studios is not necessarily the food spotlight of Disney World at the moment anyhow, right? So if you happen to be in there and you don't want to do Brown Derby, sci-fi is too dark and weird, and 50s primetime creeps you out because they'll make you stand in the corner, well, then Mama Melrose might be the one you choose. It's good if you're craving Italian. The service has always been okay for me. And I'm not going to tell you not to go to Mama Melrose. It's perfectly acceptable, but it isn't probably the best food in Disney World. It's not the best experience in Disney World. So that's why it kind of lands itself on this list. All right, next, Pizza Rizzo. Ah, Pizza Rizzo. Weird Disney puffy pizza and cannolis that are all right, but we probably wouldn't order them again. The Muppets theming is fun, but we'd rather dine pretty much anywhere else in Hollywood Studios. Not gonna lie. And next up is another Italian restaurant, Terralina Crafted Italian. Now, this makes it on the just not that good list, but I promise there is a really good one coming up. Now, Terralina gets overshadowed by almost everything else around it. You definitely get sort of an Olive Garden vibe here. The food is better than Olive Garden, but there's nothing unique or special that you'll only find at Disney World here. They do offer some great discounts and promos though, so keep an eye on their social media if you're looking for some bargains and you happen to be spending a lot of time in Disney Springs. And one time I had like a fried spaghetti ball here that was super cool. I've had some really good desserts here before, so there are are very promising things about Terralina, but overall as a whole package, it's not all that exciting. Moving on to Paradiso 37, another Disney Springs restaurant makes the list. Paradiso 37 is a Latin restaurant with some solid tacos and again, some great deals and happy hour specials, but it's nothing phenomenal. The meals we've had here aren't bad, but they also aren't anything we're clamoring to tell you guys about. So it's good if you're looking for a spot to celebrate Taco Tuesday and you happen to be in Disney Springs, but mostly it's a place you can probably skip. And this is a weird one to land on this list, Cape May Cafe. I know you guys are shocked, I'm shocked too, what can we say? If you are not a seafood lover, the dinner buffet at Cape May Cafe at the Beach Club is not for you. Even if you are a seafood lover, there are so many better options for crab legs and peel and eat shrimp in Disney World. Now they do have those awesome Oreo bonbons, but you can get those in the Beach Club Marketplace. And they do offer a character breakfast, so the whole restaurant is closed right now, with Minnie, Daisy, Goofy, and some other friends in beachy outfits. So if you're staying at Beach Club or Yacht Club, you want a character breakfast, this is a great option. It's usually cheaper, and again, it's a buffet, so it'll please everybody. So it's a good option if you want a character breakfast, but you won't meet Mickey there, just FYI. But otherwise, there may be better options for you in terms of seafood restaurants or character breakfasts. All right, heading back over to Hollywood Studios, ABC Commissary. Hollywood Studios is full of a lot of restaurants that are just okay, and some you haven't really heard of before. An ABC Commissary is kind of out of the way now that you can enter Galaxy's Edge from two places. You don't really ever need to pass this restaurant. Still, if you're looking for a meal that is faster than table service, but a little more substantial than a quick service, this is a pretty good bet. We've actually enjoyed some of the new menu options like pot roast and a shrimp teriyaki bowl, so they're making some positive changes or going in the right direction. And next to Pizzafari, this Animal Kingdom pizza restaurant has those same puffy pizzas that you'll find at Pizza Rizzo. Do any of you remember when Mark Summers did his Food Network show about how they make the puffy pizzas at Disney World? And there's literally like an assembly line machine that just like creates the puffy pizza. If you did, leave me a comment because we're both really old probably. But yes, I do remember that. This is definitely conveyor belt pizza. But there is one redeeming factor here, the family style meal at dinner. Now this meal comes with a shared salad, pasta, pizza that is 1,000 times better than the little personal pizzas you'll find during the rest of the day, and cannolis for dessert. Now at $19.99 for adults and $11.99 for guests ages 3 to 9, it's a pretty good deal for the amount of food you get, because I think it is all you care to eat. Now Pizzafari is currently closed, but we hope this family style meal comes back when it reopens. It's a hidden gem, something a lot of people don't know about, but it is worth it. And let's talk about Abracadabar. Okay, this lounge on Disney's boardwalk seems like it would be awesome. It's themed after turn of the century magicians. Some of the drinks change color, or at least they're supposed to, but it doesn't totally deliver on everything it could be. When it first opened, magic was a big part of it. A lot of the drinks changed color. A lot of the drinks had magical, you know, qualities. They did certain cool things. That kind of all went by the wayside, and now the menu's just kind of boring. And yeah, they've got some cool theming in there, but it's just really not what I think they originally hoped it was going to be. Now the place is cool, the bathrooms are fun, but it just doesn't measure up to Disney World's other lounges. Now here's a little special secret about this place. If you guys remember, the location of Abracadabra used to be Seashore Suites, which was a candy store, and it was located between the two table service restaurants right next to it. So Flying Fish, which is the fancy signature restaurant for the boardwalk, and then the ever-changing restaurant, which is currently Trattoria Al Forno, but has been multiple things in the past 10 years that never seemed to stick. But weirdly, you had to go into Seashore Suites to use the restroom, and that's because the Seashore Suites area was originally supposed to be a lounge that served both of the table service restaurants and also held the restrooms for the two table service restaurants. Now, Michael Eisner decided he wanted a candy store because what's an Atlantic City boardwalk without a candy store, right? And so it was turned into a candy store, but soon it was renovated back into a lounge, and that's what Abracadabra serves the purpose of. Okay, so our next category for restaurants you never heard of, well, they're not at Disney. Now, they may be on property, quote unquote, meaning they are on the property that's owned by Walt Disney World, but they're not at a Disney hotel or park, which means a lot of people have never heard of them. These are all located at the Swan and Dolphin, which is just a walk from Epcot and Hollywood Studios, or the Four Seasons, which you can get to via car or rideshare. Now, the Fountain. You'll find some awesome comfort food and tasty ice cream over at the Fountain at the Dolphin Resort. Burgers, sandwiches, hot dogs, chili soup, and a delicious apple pie caramel sundae are on the menu. Prices are super reasonable here for the whole family to have dinner and dessert. You won't blow your budget. So this is a great, great option if you happen to be staying at the Swan and Dolphin, or if you're at Epcot or Hollywood Studios and you want a relatively inexpensive meal. The Fountain is a great option within walking distance for you. Also at the Dolphin is Shula's Steakhouse. Now, this is named after the location's original owner, an American football great, the late Don Shula. And it's a traditional steakhouse, a very traditional steakhouse. We're talking wood paneling, giant, giant steaks served on big platters, large portions, shareable sides, that whole thing. Now, you have a lot of options for steak in Disney World, but this really is one of the best. All right, Il Molino, New York Trattoria, located at Walt Disney World's Swan Hotel. This one serves traditional dinners from the Abruzzi region of Italy. I've been teasing a good Italian restaurant this whole video, and this is it. Awesome pasta that you can get in half portions. The best meatballs ever. This is diverse regional cuisine done exceptionally well, but no one ever comes here because they don't realize it's there. So if you're looking for great Italian food at a reasonable price that doesn't feel mass-produced, Il Molino's it. All right, Blue Zoo, Todd English's signature restaurant at the Dolphin Resort in Disney World, is pretty well known and highly acclaimed for its seafood and innovative menu items. Now, it is expensive, but this restaurant is okay for special occasions and celebrations for sure. Now, over at the Four Seasons, let's talk about Ravello. This is some more Italian food. Ravello serves up some fine dining Italian cuisine in the evening, and it has a character meal on Thursday and Saturday mornings, as well as select Tuesdays. And that character meal includes Minnie, Mickey, and Goofy. So, oh my goodness, three of the Fab Five, including Mickey Mouse. That's amazing. So if you're staying at the Four Seasons, lucky, lucky you, but you also have a character meal right downstairs. And then Cappa is also over at Four Seasons. It's on the 17th floor rooftop, and it's a Spanish-influenced steakhouse, offers fresh Florida seafood in small plates. It's some seriously fine dining with Wagyu beef on the menu along with a full raw bar. Time it right and you could catch the fireworks once they're back, of course. All right, the next category of restaurants you've never heard of are the ones that it takes a long time to get to in Disney World. These restaurants are good, but you're going to need to take a Disney bus or drive yourself, which makes it a little less convenient than many other restaurants, which means they don't get recommended as often. So we're going to start with Boat Rights, which I love and everyone else hates. Just going to give you that straight up truth and transparency. It's over at Port Orleans Riverside. It's a casual restaurant featuring Southern Louisiana favorites. It's a great spot to seek out if you're looking for a quiet table service dinner outside of the parks. And if you go, please get the Mardi Gras fritters. But of course, you can't go until the resort and restaurant reopen, so fingers crossed. They also have some really, really killer cornbread here and a really good prime rib. I just keep thinking about stuff I like there. Sorry, I'll stop talking about it now. All right, Three Bridges. We're headed to Coronado Springs Resort for the next two on our list. You'll need to take a bus or drive to get there, but it might be worth a trip for these. Three Bridges Bar and Grill at Villa del Lago is in the middle of the hotel's lake and serves upscale Spanish-inspired food like queso, braised pork tacos, and other shared plates and burgers. This is outside. It's a kind of a pool bar feel, but it's really chill and relaxed. Now remember, this is a convention hotel, so you're going to have a lot of conventioneers around. So just be prepared for that, but it's a lovely location. And if you already happen to be staying at Coronado Springs, make sure to work this into your plans. And Toledo and the Dahlia Lounge. You're going to find cuisine inspired by Spain, including seafood and steak options, at this rooftop restaurant at Grandestino Tower at Coronado Springs. If you don't want to deal with an advanced dining reservation, you can grab some small plates and cocktails at the neighboring really, really beautiful BTW Dahlia Lounge. Both have awesome views of Disney World. And then Olivia's Cafe. We talk about this restaurant at Disney's Old Key West Resort a lot, but you won't find anybody else talking about it very much. The menu features classic American fare, items inspired by the Florida Keys, including those conch fritters, the Duval Street burger. Sometimes they took it off the menu for a little bit this year. And the key lime tart, which is absolutely delicious. And there's banana bread French toast for breakfast. So seriously, what else do you want? But I get it. Nobody wants to go to Old Key West. It's too far away. I understand. But if you are staying there, and remember, those rooms are a lot bigger than all the other rooms in Disney World, this is a good option. And then our final category of restaurants you never really hear about are the ones that are really pricey, but there are other things that are pricey and better. So these are not bad, but they're not exceptional value when compared to other Disney World restaurants at a similar price point. So if you're gonna spend that much, you're gonna go to the best restaurant, right? Not the kind of next best restaurant. But check menus. These could be your perfect dining restaurant because the atmospheres are different from those uber popular restaurants. First one we're gonna talk about is Narcoossee's. This is an upscale casual seafood restaurant right on the water at the Grand Floridian Resort. The seafood is truly great here, and we've had a few fantastic meals, but for most people, the price tag and the seafood-heavy menu is not a perfect fit, especially when there are many other fine dining restaurants nearby, even right in the same hotel. Next up is the Boathouse. Well, there are certainly opportunities to splurge at this Disney Springs restaurant on dishes like Maine lobster tail, Oscar, or one of the Gibson's heritage steaks. The spot also offers a more casual outdoor menu and sandwiches. You'll also find a full raw bar here, but if the standard menu is too pricey, opt for that outdoor menu for some bargains. I really enjoy the Boathouse. I really like it. It's a huge, huge, huge restaurant. Usually there's something here for everyone, but I understand that the price point can be a little bit intimidating. Also in Disney Springs, we're going to talk about that big steamboat restaurant, Paddlefish. The menu features plenty of fresh seafood along with chops and steaks, and this restaurant is good and there's a nice rooftop bar, but a meal here can be expensive and it tends to be overshadowed by those other great restaurants in Disney Springs that are super themed and super fun and just have more draw. And Monsieur Paul, our last pricey meal, is found in Epcot's France Pavilion. Monsieur Paul is a high-end, French-inspired menu, and it is exceptional but expensive, with options for multi-course meals and full wine pairings. If you love French cuisine and want a fancy meal in the parks, this is going to be a great option. Now, while these restaurants don't get talked about very often, there are some great hidden gems in here. Did you just find a new favorite restaurant that was flying totally under the radar? How many of these have you heard of before, and how many have you dined in? Let us know your thoughts in the comments. It's okay. I can take it. I understand. If you disagree, we want to hear about it, and so do our viewers. Thank you guys for listening, and thanks for watching. As always, this is AJ for Disney Food Blog, and we'll see you real soon.